Something seems to change at this time of year. No one shares the same joy as the summer months, but every isolated soul bonds in the knowledge that the great hibernation is on its way. I fail to recognise Cumbria at this time of year. The lonely silence of the streets fill with self-indulged southerners, carrying their almond milk gingerbread lattes while scrolling for the latest brand of ethically sourced carbon-neutral Christmas cake.
Yeah?
I haven't got long. I can always rely on the salty air of the beach to render me defenceless to the echoes of childhood nostalgia. I met my girlfriend on the beach. I remember the fresh breeze whipped to the parts of my face left exposed from my cheap scarf. Our feet slipped and crunched on the damp pebbles. My girlfriend is so average. She is the kind of person that gets excited when she finds a miniature grape. Occasionally, I'll look through notes she left me. Old shopping lists and poems I'd written for her. She says I'm a great poet, but I think she says that just to impress me. It works. People come into your life three times before they leave. She's on her second lap. The involuntary isolation of the same four walls is beginning to take its toll now. The blue days of December have all merged into one eternal post-lunch slump. Maybe I should try yoga. Or Pilates. They're meant to be good for your mental well-being. I don't know why I'm telling you all this. Maybe I'm barking up the wrong tree. The wrong tree. Why do we say we're barking up the wrong tree? We don't bark. We're not dogs. I haven't got long. The childish gleam of Christmas has faded to nothing greater than a dull ache. An unitchable itch at best. The suffocation in the form of forced company with distant relatives. I got my diagnosis last Christmas. When you think about it, inhaling burning air into fleshy cavities inside your chest doesn't seem at all appealing. All things considered, I should probably quit. Sometimes I feel like it's the only time I have to myself. The only time I have to think about things. To digest the happenings of my days. Because I haven't got long.
Your picture is still on my wall. On my wall, the color.
My first recollection of the ponies is falling off one when I was probably about 4 years old. So it wasn't exactly that I made a connection, it was more of the fact that I was on top of a big hairy thing and then I fell off it and hurt myself. You know, I grew up around the ponies, so although my parents separated when I was very small, I didn't live with my dad, and my dad is where the ponies were. But I used to go and stay there, and obviously the ponies was a big thing. My family has been breeding fell ponies since 1957, and my dad started breeding with a couple of mares and a stallion. When everybody else was getting out horses and getting into tractors, he kind of saw the benefits of ponies. And then my sister, who's quite a bit older than me, she got heavily involved when she was younger, and then I took over the herd in 1995, and now I've got a 16-year-old daughter, Flo, who's heavily involved with the ponies as well. Fell ponies were bred as pack ponies for centuries, so they're native to this part of the world, and up until the turnpike roads came in, pretty much everything in Cumbria was carried on the backs of ponies with pack saddles, and trains of ponies going from Kendal to London, I think twice a week. Although most natives, you could probably say the same thing, fell ponies are extremely hardy, so they can winter out and survive and actually do well out on the fells and the commons where there's not much good to eat. So they're very, very hardy. Some of these ponies I've known, you know, I've got a 26-year-old pony that I've known since she was a foal. So I have deep and meaningful relationships with a lot of these ponies, especially the ones I've been travelling with. You do any length of travelling on the roads with an animal and you get to know each other, and you get to know each other's tricks and each other's ways, and you can communicate on one level. Obviously that's like quite different to speaking with a person, but I regard these ponies as my family, most definitely. Fell pony breeders are endangered, actually, as much as the fell ponies are. The breeders are in decline because it's an aging population of breeders, and who's going to take on a herd of horses because it's not an easy way to make a living. You think about stepping away from it all every day in the middle of winter when you're up to your knees in mud, like, why am I doing this? What's the point? I think, you know, there's times where you obviously make choices in your life, and I chose to take this path, and once I've chosen that, you're kind of on it. You know, like I said at the start, you know, these horses are my family now. You can't just walk away from them. Do I feel a responsibility to... I don't feel a responsibility to continue the tradition. It's just, it's much deeper than a responsibility. It's just what I do. I made a decision 25 years ago to take on this herd of horses, and that's probably the best decision I ever made in my life. They're very grounding ponies, very humbling. But they also give you, doing the kind of stuff I do with them, freedom. You know, I could just take off tomorrow with all of them. There's something really powerful in being able to do that. You know, not many people really know me, actually, so I don't really care how they perceive me. I'm just doing my own thing, whatever they think or not. It doesn't matter, I'm just doing it anyway, so.
And lastly, what's the main emotion you feel towards your future as well as the fell ponies?
Interesting question. Optimistic. Where do I see myself in the future? Sitting in this chair with a longer beard, a bit greyer, talking about ponies.
I'm bushels of fun. Now the jingle hop has begun. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock.
This is Gina. She is 17 years old, and she has absolutely no clue how to take care of herself. From the time of her birth until just recently, everything was done for her. Her meals prepared, her laundry washed, and even her room was thoroughly cleaned and dusted for her often. 1 month ago, on December 1st, 7.753 billion people disappeared off the face of the planet, leaving this sad excuse of a human being to fend for her own well-being.
As a very antisocial person, I found living on my own was quite fun at first. I started off by watching Love Island on repeat on Britbox, which wasn't really anything out of my ordinary routine. But with no one to really run electricity, everything just kind of shut down. I took it reasonably well. Christmas came by recently, so I bought myself a few things to keep up with the festive spirits. I was hoping to spruce up the place and make it a lot more festive for Christmas, but I couldn't find any of the decorations, so kitchen roll had to do. On Christmas Eve, I wrapped up all my presents and went to bed. I was a little disappointed in the morning when I saw that Santa hadn't come like he usually does. But I guess he disappeared like everyone else in the world. However, I did open my presents, but I was even more disappointed to find out that I already knew what I had because I bought them. Things weren't all that bad though. I found another person. Meet Andrew. He's good fun. We play board games together and he is really good company and I enjoy having him around. The only problem is that he doesn't really talk often and I have to carry him everywhere or kick him around like a ball. Crap. It was hard to cope on my own at the beginning of all this. I'm not really used to actually doing anything. But I think over the past few months, I've really shown how independent I can be, and I'm really proud of what I've accomplished. I have really high hopes for the future.
Gina died 2 days later after trying to cook some sausages upon a propane tank. Although Gina didn't last very long, she sure as hell lasted longer than most would have thought. She didn't give up, and her determination to keep civilized as well as trying to survive would have inspired many, if they were still around.